The following video was sponsored by the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia, preserving and promoting our community's history.
I remember my first experience in art. I call it an aesthetic experience for a young child. My father had brought a big bushel of grapes from the fields in my little village in Laconia. And he lifted up the grapes and he said, "Hey, Kostaki, look at these grapes." And the sun hit the grapes in such a beautiful manner that I was just bedazzled. And I was just 4 years old and I didn't know anything about art or the experience of art. But in retrospect, I remember it now as that kind of early, very exciting visual statement. And I made him lift him up again and I said, "Lift them up again. I wanted to see the light again." And he did it again. And then he puts them down. Then I said, "Do it again." And he got angry with me because he thought I was playing with him. But that was the first experience I had that I remember as that related to painting itself.
Our guest today hails from Waco, Texas. However, he's been in the Wilmington area for, as he said, a lifetime. His epiphany took place in Laconia, Greece, where he was born, but not raised. Meet our guest now, Gus Sermas. Gus, welcome to Cosmos Philly.
Thank you very much, Ted. I appreciate you coming to my studio and looking at my work and asking me these questions about my heritage. My Greek heritage has been very important to me. And even though I speak very little Greek, I speak enough to get by, but I read a little bit daily to try to keep it up. But in my work, I use it as far as mythology is concerned, because mythology is always with me in my daily life. I use it in my paintings. The subject matter, especially the titles, relate to always something mythological. Mm-hmm. One of my primary themes is Persephone, and especially it's timely today because of our concern about the weather and the global warming and so forth. And all my work is taken or derived or alluded to in nature. And you can see that I'm basically an expressionist painter.
Is that how you describe yourself?
Yeah, I would describe myself as an expressionist painter, more than a realist, because an expressionist takes what he sees or she sees into themselves and then brings it back out in an interpretive manner. Mm-hmm. And it's formalized, but it's formalized more romantically, let's say, than in a sense that it's organized and predetermined. I don't do predetermined artwork. I do it, it evolves as it moves along, as I work on it.
You mentioned something earlier about art for art's sake to me, as opposed to what commercial work is today. Could you rephrase that for us?
Well,
I dealt with being old school or something.
Yes, I'm old school in that because in my day, when I went to school, we were taught to paint for ourselves. There's a problem in that it makes it difficult to make a living in art when you paint for yourself. But that's the way I was taught, and that's the way I remained. And I was able to do it, fortunately, because I was able to teach school and support myself and be able to paint anything I wanted, when I wanted, and never be beholding to anything or to anyone. And it fell that way, whether I wanted to or not.
Let's talk about your journey becoming a painter. We know where the initial epiphany took place, but what was the path you took? How did you start out in the arts?
Well, always worked a little bit in drawing when I was a child. And I went to Baylor University, and a teacher was there that was the first Coca-Cola painter for the Coca-Cola girls in the advertisement. And he was very painterly, and he influenced me. And I went to University of Texas after that, and I worked with Vincent Mariani, an Italian who was very, very experienced in making you able to do what you wanted to do rather than what he wanted you to do. He tried to bring out the inner person, and it influenced me immensely. And he sent me to Wisconsin to study with Richard Lazzaro, who further educated me. And Richard, or Mr. Lazzaro, as I still call him, showed me how to paint in just 5 minutes. I was struggling. And he said, look, and he grabbed a dirty brush full of paint and with a great deal of linseed oil and just splashed it on there. And that's what I wanted to say, and I didn't realize that's what I wanted to say. I wanted it in color, I wanted it in texture, I wanted it to flow, I wanted to make a statement as far as the paint itself. And the struggles that I had done before, working and drawing and painting, just went all out the window. And at that moment, I knew what I was doing from then on.
What makes a good painting? How do you know a good painting when you see one?
Well, a painting, there's an artist, a great artist that worked with Picasso, George Braque, and they both invented cubism. And George Braque said that a good painting keeps on giving and giving. That means that a good painting, you can wake up in the morning and look at it, and it looks like new. And wake up the next morning and look at it, and it looks like new again. And it never, you never get tired of it. Now, a painting that you might be infatuated by and look at it and you say it's wonderful, but after you see it 5 or 6 times or after 5 or 6 months, you say, I can't stand to look at it anymore. No matter how great the technique is, no matter how talented the artist may be in expressing what he sees, he just doesn't have what it takes. Mm-hmm. There's something to a work of art that has a kind of immortality about it. That's the best way I can explain that.
Could you also talk about your work from the point of view that you mentioned to me privately, that you can take a piece, work on it, develop it, but it might not be done for years?
If you work on a work and you like it and you stop it and you say, I like the way the work is right now, but I want to say something else with it also, you can do another painting very easily if you're a realist. But if you're an expressionist and you splash the paint like I do, to do another painting is very difficult to do and get it exactly like it is and then just change it a little bit. So I just work on the painting again, and maybe I'll have 5 or 6 paintings, completed paintings, on one canvas, but only the last one you can see. See, so like that piece, I worked on that for about 10 years. It was complete the first week I did it, and then I worked on it again a couple of years later because I saw what I could do with it. Right. And then I did it about 4 or 5 times, actually, maybe a few more times than that, because I added the wings to it. I added the 2 sides to it, which makes it a triptych. And a triptych, by definition, can work individually or with all 3 pieces together. So I work primarily in a space between two dimension and three dimension. And that's been an influence from abstract painting and the icon, the icona, as the Greeks say. And as we know, the icona is a doorway between this world and the next, but it's a spiritual experience. I'm not an icon painter, because a true icon painter is inspired, and he's just a tool of the divine in doing the work. Mm-hmm. But I use some of the characteristics of icon painting, the flat, two-dimensional, lack of linear perspective, as modern art does. Mm-hmm. Those are modern art characteristics, you see.
I also noticed here at your home, there is much of the work is displayed openly here in your studio, and you've got a large collection of books. Tell us about the history of the books, when you started collecting and why.
Well, everyone in my family collects books. And I stopped collecting books when I was able to look at the computer and look things up. And it just became a habit with me. And books used to be very cheap. I used to find them very cheap. And they primarily deal with art. And because I wanted the images, and I find it very restful to look at one image after the other. Yeah. I can remember them. I can't remember people's names. I can't remember numbers. I can't do this or that. But I can remember images. Mm. I have a whole vocabulary of drawings in my head by the masters, you see. I enjoy the library. It's a space for me to escape to. And just, it's my man cave.
Who are those that inspire you from your library?
Oh, probably... That's a difficult question, because I don't have favorites.
Are there aspects of specific
yes.
things you...
The German expressionist especially, or the period in which Kandinsky painted. Kandinsky is the first serious non-representational artist. By non-representational, we mean... doesn't relate to the real world. It's a world in and of itself, you see. And I like that period very much. I also like the Fauves, the French expressionists, because they, 1905, 1906, because they use color as a pure statement. And they used arbitrary color. For example, if a tree is green, they might decide to make it red because it relates better to the canvas. So the result or the end is how the canvas feels rather than being a facsimile or a mirror image of nature, mm-hmm. you see.
You mentioned technology earlier in our conversation. Has that played a role or changed or altered your painting technique or style?
Yes. It has influenced me, but it hasn't changed my technique or style. What it has done, it has enhanced me. I'm not good on computers. I was forced to learn it at school because we had to learn it. And it was a good experience. And what I like is... I can take a picture now of my paintings because it's so easy to do things today. And I can put it in the computer and I can change the colors. And it fascinates me and it satisfies me. And I do it for fun. And it doesn't overly influence me when I do my painting, because I'm already doing it in my head a little bit, but it's fun to see, and it gives you ideas. It gives you ideas. So I use it as a tool, and I think it's a great tool.
And you've embraced it, apparently.
Oh, yes, I've embraced it. I wish I could manage that computer stuff like the kids do, but I can't. But I always have, at school, I always had students help me in operating everything, you know.
Are there challenges or areas of the arts or painting even that you feel like you've yet to explore, you'd like to explore?
Yeah, there is. It's a... I enjoy, as you can see, a lot of color and a lot of activity on the surface of the canvas. And but I also enjoy that classical calm that 5th century Greek art had. And it had a minimal statement. You know, there's a difference between the Hellenistic period and the classical period. And so I'm more of a Hellenistic Greek than a classical Greek. But the classical Greek is more ordered. And the minimalist art is saying as little as possible, saying as much as possible, that is, with as little as possible put down. For example, this little piece up there, that's a minimal piece. And of course, it relates, I related to the Trojan War, you know, when Troy was destroyed, like that one there relates to the Trojan War. But I think that the minimal statement is important for me because it's a nice break when I love my filled up juicy paint that I call, you know.
Let me throw you a hypothetical here. We've talked about 19th, 20th century art. If you could have been born in a different time frame, what time frame would you have liked to have been a painter in and why?
Well, there's two or three places.
Okay.
I would have liked the Renaissance in Florence because the Florentines looked back to the Greco-Roman world and they made a statement like no one has ever done before. Only the classical Greeks compete with the Florentines. You see. And that would have been, I would have liked to have worked with an artist named Del Sarto, Andrea Del Sarto. Michelangelo used to call him Mr. Perfect because his works look so perfect. Now, the first abstractionist, in my opinion, in my personal opinion, is El Greco. He was a mannerist. I would have liked to have seen him and met him and just what made him tick to be able to do what he did. He was so conceited in some respects that he said that he should repaint the Sistine Chapel. It is said, we think he said that. But his work relates very much to another worldly feel to it, being influenced by Iconis, being a Greek like he was. But another period I would have enjoyed immensely would have been the Romantic era. Now, the Romantic era right before the Impressionist era is interesting for me because it looks at the world through the world of paint. And it denies the neoclassical approach, the trying to idealize as perfect as possible. Mm-hmm. And it lets paint make its own statement and suggest. In other words, they would put things down on the canvas that would be more than the artist was putting down because it would suggest something to you besides what it's saying, you see.
Let's talk a little bit now about your family, your siblings, your parents, what role they might have played in your life, a little bit of history of Laconia,
I was lucky in some respects. I've been influenced very much by my brother, who's practical. He's the worker in the family. I was the guy who was considered lazy. And they gave me an opportunity to do what I wanted to. So, and I remember even when I was a young child, my mother used to say, Paul works, you're not that kind of a guy. So it gave me an opportunity to just do whatever I wanted to because I fell under that label. And when I was going to school studying art, I wasn't being very practical. And I told my mother one day, I said, I have to do it, it's in my blood. Mm-hmm. And she said, Stoema suine. And she accepted it and never questioned me again. You see? So in other words, I had encouragement to do what I wanted to do. And my father was the same kind of person. He encouraged you to do things. So I never had a problem with art. It was something that if I wanted it, I would go after it no matter what the results would be. So we went to Greece. When my parents went to Greece in 1938, they had come from Greece, of course, and my brother and sister were born here, and they went back for a trip, and they got stuck there because the British were controlling the seas because of the German U-boats, and no one could get out, as I understand the history of it. So we remained there till 1945. So we came back after that, and we moved to Waco, Texas. And my uncle and my two uncles and my father worked in the food business, the restaurant business. And our cousins worked in the restaurant business locked up in Waco, you know. And that's my story.
Well, I'm curious to hear a little bit more, if there is, your the Greek community, were you involved with it? Was there a Greek community? Well, did you go to church? What was what was your association with Hellenism?
Well, I was, being Greek, you're Greek Orthodox, automatically. But in Waco, we did not have a church. We did not have a Greek priest. And so the priest from San Antonio used to come in once in a while, or the one from Dallas. But those were distant places, right. You know. And we occasionally used to take maybe once or twice a year a drive to Dallas or to San Antonio, mm-hmm. Fort Worth, that is, to church.
Were there any traditional customs events like Easter is a big one?
Yes.
Did you commemorate or celebrate these?
Yeah,
these?
That whatever Greek that I know celebrates Easter. And that was a yearly event for us, of course. And the Greeks of Waco used to meet together and have picnics and so forth and celebrate different Greek events.
Were you drawn to any of this, you were an artist, but were you drawn to trying to preserve some of this in your day, in your life as you got older? Or was it something that just subtly played a role of influence, but not really?
It played a role of influence. Even though I'm not the overly church-going type, I'm a believer in the Greek church.
Right.
I'm a Greek Orthodox. And I think one, if they're Greek, they're Greek forever. Whether they forget how to speak Greek or whatever, they're Greek forever.
You continue to paint you continue to show, give us a little idea about how often you're doing both of these things.
Okay. Well, I show every year at Cerulean Blue Gallery in Philadelphia, that's operated by Michael Kobutz and Tina. And they're very supportive. And they enjoy abstraction very much, besides realism and naturalism in art. But they keep a few pieces there. So if anyone wants to see them, it's on Ridge Street in Philadelphia. And I show here in Wilmington at the Blue Street Gallery two or three times a year. And so I have those two opportunities. And people sometimes collect my work a little bit, you know, which makes it nice. But I'm very pleased with the way my life has turned out. It wasn't a real struggle to do art.
The teaching, what kind of role did that play in your life? Was it an enjoyable process for you? Did it help you? Did you love the process of sharing and communicating?
Teaching was easy for me. I think it was easy because I was able to deal with the subjects that I enjoyed immensely. And I taught painting. And the kind of painting I taught was the kind of painting I was taught, the approach, the expressionistic approach. And that seemed to register with young people. Rather than being told what to do, to be able to express themselves and to be told what to do at the same time. But self-expression is very significant. And I was able to teach drawing too. And so it was really like going to the candy store, the teaching experience. It did not feel like work. And I've been very blessed in that respect.
Do you have a final thought, a motto that you'd like to share that you live by?
Oh, that's very
or a thought. I mean, I think we've
Well, I have a friend that we sometimes paint together. He comes over and we paint together. And he can't get over the fact that I sit, his name is Robert Waddington, he's an artist, good artist. And he can't get over the fact that I always want to stop and eat. And he's the kind that works. And I keep on telling him that the best times are wasted times. Because you can sit back and look at things and enjoy them. And when people have a guilt out of the enjoyment of things, sometimes when you just sit and do not a thing and just look at things, an artist told me one time, a wonderful artist, I taught with her for years. She said to me, I saw a beautiful bush I wanted to paint, but then I decided, why do I want to paint it? I just look at it. And I thought that was very telling of her because she can paint beautifully, you see. Mm-hmm. I think that we don't have time to look at things today and just sit back because of the way the world is today. Very fast moving. When someone sits down, they're on their phone. Like me, I'm on my phone. And so I have to catch myself and say I have to sit back and waste time.
Sit back and waste time?
Yeah.
What a wonderful thought.
Yeah.
Gus, thank you for having us here in your studio.
Thank you.
We wish you the best of luck. Thank you again.
Thank you, Ted, very much for visiting. I appreciate it very much.
For more information about sponsoring or viewing the interview series, visit the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia online at ghsp.org.